Dámy a páni, všetci fanúšikovia dobrej literatúry a ľudia, ktorí radi čítate, vítajte pri ďalšom pokračovaní Absintéky. Dnes je tretí večer, kedy sa rozprávame so zaujímavými ľuďmi. Rozprávam sa s nimi ja, moje meno je Samo Marec. Mojím hosťom dnes je Steve Zilberman a budeme sa rozprávať kvôli tejto knihe Neurokmene, ktorá vyšla v roku 2015, ale v slovenskom preklade vychádza práve teraz. A či už nás sledujete prostredníctvom stránky Absintu alebo denníka SME, ktorým takisto ďakujeme, alebo aj niekde inde, tak sme veľmi radi a ideme na to, pretože nás čaká veľmi, veľmi zaujímavý rozhovor o autizme, o neurodiverzite, o neurokmeňoch a ešte aj o tých veciach, ktoré by ste možno ani nečakali. Takže ja sa hneď obrátim na Steve'a. Hello, Steve. Greetings to San Francisco. How are you today?
Hello. Nice to see you. Thank you very much for having me here.
Sorry for doing this so early in the morning for you, but...
No problem. Glad to be
books,
here.
Books won't wait.
Yes.
I'm going to start with a thing that we discussed in the last few minutes while we were waiting. You were a teaching assistant to Allen Ginsberg.
Yes, the poet.
And
he went to Czechoslovakia in 1965. Yeah. And the students elected him the Král Majáles, or King of May. And it was, you know, he was a rebel. And so he wasn't supposed to be elected King of May, but by popular demand, they elected him. And then the secret police confiscated his notebooks and he was thrown out of the country. But that happened. He wrote a very beautiful poem about it called Král Majáles.
And you promised you were going to send it to me. So now it's recorded, so we have to do it.
Yes, I will do it, yes.
Yeah, thank you so much. Steve okrem iného pôsobil ako asistent na vysokej škole známeho, svetoznámeho básnika Alana Ginsberga, ktorý v roku 1965 navštívil Prahu a stal sa tam kráľom Majálesu. Ľudia ho zvolili. A ako Steve hovorí, Alan Ginsberg bol rebel, niečo podobné sa nemalo stať, ale jednoducho ľudia ho zvolili. Následne EŠTB samozrejme ho deportovala za hranice, ale musel odísť. Ale od Steve'a som sa dozvedel, že on má nahrávku, originálnu nahrávku Alana Ginsberga, keď recituje tú báseň Král Majáles, slúbil mi, že mi ju pošle, tak sa na to veľmi teším. In this article in 2015, it was actually, I think it was called My Hero.
Oh, yes.
Why is that?
Why is that? Yeah. Because one of the, well, Alan's greatest poem, I think, is called Kaddish, which is the name of the Hebrew prayer for the dead. And Kaddish is a book-length poem. It's like a novel. And it was written about his mother, Naomi, who had schizophrenia and died in an institution. And mm-hmm. Alan always stood up for homeless people, people who are addicted to drugs, working class people, minorities, sexual minorities, people who were being oppressed by the capitalist system. And so I was inspired by him to both be a very careful user of words. Like I try to use very precise words like he did, but I also tried to stand up for people whose voices are silenced in the general public's conversation. Mm-hmm. And so in a sense, Neurotribes was almost like an extension of Kaddish because he wrote about people in mental asylums who had been completely exiled from society. And in many ways, people with autism have been treated as badly as the people that Allen Ginsberg wrote about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Ten článok, ktorý Steve napísal Alanovi Ginsbergovi v roku 2015, sa volá My Hero. Opýtal som sa prečo. A začalo sa to teda tak, že Allen Ginsberg napísal báseň Kadesh, čo je po hebrejsky modlitba pre mŕtvych. A je to dlhá kniha, je skoro ako román a je o jeho mame Naomi, ktorá trpela na schizofréniu a zomrela v ústave. A teda Allen Ginsberg bol človek, ktorý sa vždy zastával drogovo závislých, bezdomovcov, menšín ako takých sexuálnych menšín, pracujúcich, všetkých tých ľudí, ktorí boli nejakým spôsobom utlačaní. A Steve sa od neho naučil poprvé opatrne používať slova, čo ho sa snaží držať vo svojej tvorbe. A okrem toho teda aj zastať sa ľudí, ktorých celkom nie je počuť. A v tom zmysle tie neurokmene sú iba takým rozšírením Kadešu, pretože sa pojednávajú teda o autizme a o tom, ako my sa veľmi často k ľuďom s autizmom správame, práve tak, ako aj Allen Ginsberg to opisoval. And then in 2001 I wrote this article called The Geek Syndrome. And actually, I read in a review where they said it was culturally significant. So it made a big impact. Well, why was that?
Yeah. The Geek Syndrome, which was printed in the magazine called Wired, which I used to write for many years, was the first article in mainstream journalism to talk about autism in high-tech communities like Silicon Valley. At the time, there was a mistaken belief, a myth, a lie, that vaccines cause autism. What really causes autism is genetics, primarily. And so at the time, 2001, there was this very panic dialogue about how vaccines were causing autism or maybe computers were causing autism. That was all not true. What was true was that the same genes that cause autism can produce advantages in some people in working in technology, having a very good memory or having the ability to concentrate on one thing for a long time. So the Geek Syndrome was kind of revolutionary in that instead of saying, oh my God, there's an autism epidemic, which is what people were saying at the time, what I said was that the same genes that caused people to be good at working in the technology industry could also cause autism, particularly in the next generation.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what happened in America in 2001. It's 2021 here in Slovakia, and a lot of people still believe that vaccines actually cause autism. So I think we're lagging behind you. We're 20 years late in this regard.
Well, unfortunately right now, because of COVID, those same liars are now very loud again and saying that vaccines are harmful. And it just is not true. There have been many, 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 many studies of vaccines and autism, and none of them have come to the conclusion that vaccines cause autism. Not only that, the fact that autism is genetic was proven by a British psychiatrist named Michael Rutter, who just died the other day, actually. So he was a very important figure in history. And he did a study in the, I believe it was in the 1970s, of twins that proved that autism was primarily genetic and not caused by anything like vaccines.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm gonna translate this whole discussion now.
I'm sorry. Should I speak more?
No problem at all.
No, we're fine. Okay, all right.
Absolutely not. Opýtal som sa Steva na jeho článok The Geek Syndrome z roku 2001, ktorý vyšiel vtedy v časopise Wired, pre ktorý písal, lebo sa o ňom hovorilo, že bol z kultúrneho hľadiska veľmi, veľmi významný v tom, ako zmenil pohľad na autizmus. Opýtal som sa prečo. Povedal mi, že to bolo prvýkrát, čo vlastne v mainstreamových médiách sa zaoberal niekto témou, že autizmus v tých high-tech komunitách, napríklad v Silicon Valley, sa môže vyskytovať veľmi, veľmi často a že to nemusí byť úplne zlé, pretože práve v tom čase, okolo roku 2001, existoval ten mýtus a to klamstvo, že vakcíny spôsobujú autizmus. Hovorilo sa aj, že počítače môžu spôsobovať autizmus. A sú vtedy teda prišiel s tým, že tie isté gény, ktoré ten autizmus spôsobujú, lebo vieme, že sú to gény, tak práve napríklad pri práci v technológiách môžu veľmi dobre pomôcť, lebo títo ľudia si výborne pamätajú veci, dokážu sa výnimočne koncentrovať. Hovorilo sa vtedy aj o tom, že existuje nejaká epidémia autizmu, čo samozrejme nie je pravda. A práve preto sme nadviazali ešte ďalšou otázkou na tie vakcíny a na COVID. Steve povedal, že neexistuje ani jedna štúdia, ktorá by dokazovala nejakú súvislosť a že naopak už od roku 1970 máme jasné štúdie o tom, že autizmus je geneticky spôsobovaný. But your book primarily, well, there's a lot of information in it, but One of them is the history of our understanding of autism, I guess. That's how I...
Oh, yes, absolutely. That's definitely true. Yes.
And yep. And there have been some very interesting steps in that. First, mm-hmm. I mean, one of them was, it was being diagnosed as schizophrenia.
Mm-hmm.
Why is that? I mean...
Why is that? Well, the word autism was actually invented by a psychiatrist named Eugen Bleuler. And he did not mean it to describe, to he did not mean to name a condition. He was describing someone who seemed very isolated in themselves. Autism in English means like selfism. So it's someone who was confined in themselves. And then a guy in America named Leo Kanner, a child psychiatrist, described people with autism as autistic in the same way that Bleuler had meant it. But then that word became the name for the whole condition. Kanner also believed that autism was a childhood condition only, and that when people grew up with autism, they would become schizophrenic. That was not true. But for many years, it was believed to be true. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, some of the characteristics, well, some of the characteristics he described of children being very isolated, like they didn't want to even know their own parents, that was like communication difficulties, but he thought they had no interest in their parents or were not capable of loving their parents. That was all wrong. So the connection between autism, they can occur together, but there's no mm-hmm. formal connection between autism and schizophrenia.
Okay. Tá kniha Neurokmeňa, o ktorej sa rozprávame, je do veľkej miery akoby históriou našich vedomostí o autizme a veľmi často sa tam okrem iného spomína schizofrénia. A dozvedeli sme sa ale teda od Steva, že ten pojem autizmus, ten pochádza od rakúskeho psychologa Eugena Breulera, ktorý ani nechcel opísať nejaký syndrom, ale chcel opísať to, čo videl pre celého toho izolovaného človeka a ten výraz autizmus vlastne znamená, neviem to teraz narýchlo preložiť, ale niečo ako selfism, teda človek zameraný, ponorený do seba. Potom prišiel americký psycholog Leo Kanner a ten teda začal používať aj to slovo autistický. A on tomu rozumel tak, že autistické sú iba deti, iba v detstve a potom ako človek dospieva, tak sa to autizmus zmizne a ostane z toho schizofrénia, sa z toho vyvinie. Videl to veľmi často aj tam, kde to celkom nebolo, napríklad iba pri deťoch, ktoré mali nejaké komunikačné problémy s rodičmi alebo tak aj to všetko on diagnostikoval ako autizmus, ale dnes vieme, že schizofrénia s autizmom sa určite môžu objaviť naraz, ale nie sú to tie isté veci. The other thing that I found interesting was the interwar period, especially unfortunately in Nazi Germany. Where you wrote a lot about eugenics, about mm-hmm. this, you know, strive to build some kind of another mankind, pure and mm-hmm. perfect.
Right, right. I mean, people many people in America think that eugenics was a Nazi idea, but actually it was invented by American researchers, and then the Nazis adopted it and put it into practice in a horrible way by attempting to exterminate people with disabilities like people with autism. So people with autism, people with schizophrenia, people with hereditary physical disabilities were exterminated by the Nazis because they thought by getting rid of the genes that caused these conditions that mankind could be quote unquote perfected. But it resulted in one of the worst nightmares that humanity has ever faced. And what's interesting is that everyone knows that, you know, the Nazis attempted to exterminate the Jews. But what most people don't know, which I described in my book, is that the Nazis practiced before exterminating the Jews, they practiced on children with disabilities like autism.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Pomerne veľká časť knihy sa venuje aj medzivojnovému obdobiu, konkrétne eugenike. Steve hovorí, že veľa ľudí si teda myslí, že tu s tou eugenikou prišli nacisti, ale ona v skutočnosti tá teória vznikla v Amerike a nacisti si ju potom adaptovali. A s úmyslom teda zdokonaliť nejako ľudstvo a ľudskú rasu, tak ľudí s rôznymi nedostatkami, ľudí aj s autizmom, aj s fyzickým postihnutím alebo schizofréniou, sa vlastne chceli zbaviť, lebo si mysleli, že ak sa zbavia tých génov, tak to ľudstvo bude nejaké lepšie a čistejšie. Samozrejme, my vieme, že výsledkom bola katastrofa, ale teraz Steve hovorí, že mnohí ľudia vedia, že nacisti sa snažili vyvraždiť Židov, ale že v skutočnosti si to cvičili práve na tých ľuďoch, ktorí mali rôzne nedostatky. One of the things that I also found interesting was, and I'm going to return to it later again, but there is this quote where you're saying, when you start looking for autism, you find it everywhere. And at certain points in the last 5 or 6 decades, maybe, sometimes it led to this craze, to this feeling of, oh, there's an epidemic. It's terrible. It's everywhere.
Yeah. What it is, the reason why that is because autism for most of the 20th century was considered very, very rare. And the estimates of the prevalence of autism were like 1 in 10,000 children or whatever. That's completely not true. Now we know that something more like 1 in 50 or 1 in 60 children have autism. And so what happened was, for reasons that I discuss at in great detail in my book, particularly Leo Kanner, the American who was born in Eastern Europe, actually, but he moved here. He gets credit for discovering autism, but because he was trying to get his colleagues to accept the existence of a new clinical disease or a new entity, he defined it very, very strictly, too strictly. So, for instance, he thought that only upper middle class families had autistic children. That's wrong. Most of the children he described were white. Actually, autism is prevalent in every possible kind of human being. So what happened was that it took almost a century for the diagnostic descriptions of autism to match the reality, which is that there are autistic people everywhere. And even more than autistic people, there are people with autistic traits who might not get a diagnosis, but they have autism-like qualities. And so it was Hans Asperger who discovered autism in Vienna in the 1930s, who said, once you learn to recognize the distinctive traits of autism, you see them everywhere. And that was the opposite of what Leo Kanner said. And Leo Kanner became world famous as the father of autism. Leo Kanner estimated he'd only seen 150 true cases of autism in his lifetime. Mm-hmm. So Kanner was completely wrong about that, but it took science decades to catch up to what Asperger knew, which was that it was common.
Mm-hmm. V knihe okrem iného sa nachádza taký citát zaujímavý a ešte sa k tomu aj raz vrátim, že ako náhle začnete autizmus hľadať, tak ho začnete aj vidieť doslova všade. A Steve hovorí, že ono je to tým, že teda väčšinu 20. storočia sa to považovalo za veľmi zriedkavý jav, že sa teda hovorilo, že jedno dieťa z 10 000 sa s niečím podobným stretlo. Dnes vieme, že to nie je pravda, že je to skôr jedno z 50 alebo zo 60. Ale bolo to spôsobené tým, že teda ten psychológ Leo Kanner, ktorého už sme tu spomínali, on to ako keby on ten autizmus objavil a on chcel, aby to bola taká nová diagnóza, veľmi zriedkavá, veľmi špecifická, tak dal takú veľmi striktnú definíciu, napríklad, že sú to iba trpiatím iba deti z vyššej strednej triedy, iba deti bielých rodín. To dnes vieme, že to nie je pravda a vlastne skoro 100 rokov trvalo, kým nejak sa tá diagnóza stretla s realitou a preto aj dnes vieme, že okrem takéhoto autizmu existujú aj ľudia, ktorí majú iba niektoré vlastnosti alebo také črty autistické. A napríklad toto už v 30. rokoch hovoril Hans Asperger, ktorý vlastne ten autizmus vo Viedni objavil A ktorý povedal, že ako náhle viete, čo hľadáte, tak to naozaj vidíte všade. Ale slávnym sa stal ten Leo Kanner, ktorý si myslel, že naozaj za celý život videl iba 150 detí s týmto problémom a trpalo celé 10 ročia, kým sa to nejako ustálilo. And then one of the other significant moments, I think, because I remember it, is the first time I saw the movie Rain Man.
Oh, yeah.
And it sort of opened my eyes. I mean, I must have been, I don't know, 10 or 12 back then. So you don't quite understand what exactly it is that you're seeing. Yeah. But, you know, you suddenly realize that there are people who are a bit different, but they have a different set of unique skills and abilities. Was that the time? Because, I mean, it's not just the U.S. It was a worldwide success, the movie.
Yes, yes.
Was that very important for the world as such to realize that there are people like this? Was that a game changer?
Yes, it was an absolute game changer. And, in fact, it was much more of a game changer than most people think, even people who think it was an important movie, because it was the very first time ever in history that an autistic adult was seen on the screen. Up until Rain Man, autism was considered a childhood condition. It was always just children. Whenever you saw a pamphlet from an autism society, it was always pictures of children. So what happened to these children when they grew up? No one seemed to know. Leo Kanner said they would become schizophrenic. They did not, but it was as if they disappeared after they were teenagers. And so Dustin Hoffman, as the character Raymond Babbitt, was not only the first autistic adult that the world had ever seen, it was even the first autistic adult that most autism specialists had ever seen, because they focused on children. And so for autistic people seeing it, it was really a revolution, because they couldn't even get a diagnosis, because the diagnosis did not include adults when Rain Man came out. So if they looked at Dustin Hoffman and said, oh, he's like me, they couldn't even get a diagnosis yet until a few years later. And for parents of autistic kids, it was an absolute revolution, because it was the first time they'd ever seen anybody like their kids as an adult on the screen. But there was one error, or, you know, sort of bad mistake that they made in that movie, which is that at the end of the movie, Raymond Babbitt has to go back into the mental institution because he cannot survive on his own. He can't go off with his brother, Tom Cruise, and get rich at the casinos in Las Vegas. And the reason why that was a mistake was that the real autistic people that Dustin Hoffman worked with to develop the character of Raymond Babbitt did not live in institutions. But it was sort of a mistaken belief that autistic people could only survive in institutions. But other than that, Rain Man was a huge leap forward for understanding of autism.
Mm-hmm. Opýtal som sa na film, ktorý určite aj vy ste videli, na film Rain Man, ktorý asi zohral nejakú úlohu v tom v našom porozumení, že ako ľudia s autizmom vlastne vnímajú svet. Opýtal som sa na to aj Steve'a, ktorý povedal, že to bolo ešte dôležitejšie, ako si vôbec možno myslíme, pretože to bolo vôbec prvýkrát, čo dospelý človek s autizmom sa objavil. Dovtedy už aj ten psycholog Kanner, ktorého sme spomínali, on hovoril, že to boli len deti, potom, že sa z nich stanú schizofrenici. Teraz prvýkrát sa objavil dospelý človek, ktorý predtým ako keby neexistoval, ako keby tie deti potom zrazu niekde zmizli. A bola tá otázka, čo sa s nimi deje. No a tu zrazu prišiel Dustin Hoffman. Bol to prvýkrát aj vôbec aj pre nejakých špecialistov, ktorí sa touto témou zaoberajú, že uvideli autistického človeka v dospelosti. A bola to revolúcia aj pre rodičov, lebo ako keby si vedeli konečne predstaviť, ako možno to ich dieťa bude vyzerať. A bola to revolúcia aj pre ľudí, ktorých sa to týkalo, lebo dovtedy to neexistovala vlastne pre dospelých ľudí ani diagnóza, ktorú by im mohli stanoviť, a konečne videli niekoho a mohli spadať on ja ako ja. Bola tam iba jedna chyba, a tá chyba spočívala v tom, že ten film sa končí tak, že Rain Man sa vracia naspäť do ústavu, nejde s Tomom Cruiseom do kasína. A to nie je celkom pravda. Tá univerzálna predstava, že teda takíto ľudia dokážu žiť iba niekde v bezpečnom prostredí zatvorení, nie je pravdivá a práve k tomu sa aj teraz dostaneme o chvíľu. The plan is to ask you a lot of questions about how people with autism actually are, how they live and so on. But one last question about the thing that I want to know. There are so many different characters in the book and they are geniuses in their different, mm-hmm. Professions. Which one mm-hmm. is your favorite?
Lorna Wing, who was a British psychiatrist who had a very disabled autistic daughter named Susie. And in the 1970s, because of the National Health Care Service in England, she was asked to estimate the number of autistic kids in a suburb of London called Camberwell. And at that point, Leo Kanner's statement that autism was very rare was universally accepted as true among autism specialists. But when she and a colleague named Judith Gould went out to the schools and the clinics and the hospitals and the community of Camberwell, they kept seeing more autistic people than Connor would have predicted. They weren't all as strictly defined as Connor would have insisted upon. Sometimes they had what Lorna used to call bits and pieces of Connor syndrome. But it was clear that there were very many of them and that autism was not rare, but common. So it was Lorna Wing who, at first she did not know how to understand this because it seemed to disagree with what all of her colleagues thought, but or not all of her colleagues, but what most people in autism thought. And it wasn't until someone said to her, have you read this paper by Hans Asperger, which talked about a spectrum model of autism? It didn't use that word. The word that Asperger and his colleague used was continuum, but it was basically what we now understand as the autism spectrum. And when she read Asperger's paper, which no one was reading in English, because Asperger had been working, after 1938, Asperger's bosses were Nazis. He was working in Vienna. And he published that paper in a German language journal. And so people in the post-World War II era did not want to be reading German language journals, particularly from a doctor who was working under a famous Nazi named Michael Hamburger. So Asperger's paper was completely forgotten, basically. But she read it and she said, wait, Asperger was right about this. Autism is a spectrum. Leo Kanner was wrong. It's not this rare condition. And so she kind of behind the scenes worked to widen the gates of diagnosis so that more people like her daughter, Susie, and like other people who were like her or very unlike her, but had autistic traits could get a diagnosis and get the help they needed.
Mm-hmm. V tej knihe nájdete mnoho postav, historických, aj viac bližšie k súčasnosti, aj zo súčasnosti. Opýtal som sa Steva, ktorá je jeho najobľúbenejšia a dozvedeli sme sa vlastne, ako došlo k rozšíreniu tej diagnózy. K rozšíreniu tej diagnózy došlo tak, že v 70. rokoch v Londýne, na takom predmestí Camberwell vlastne, prebehol výskum, počas ktorého sa malo zistiť, koľko detí s autizmom tam vôbec je. A podľa tej Kanerovej východzej teórie to bolo tak, že by ich vlastne malo byť veľmi málo a to nebola pravda. Podľa tých striktných definícií to samozrejme pravda bola, ale ľudia, ktorí sa tomu venovali, tak zistili vlastne, že je tam veľmi veľa detí, ktoré majú napríklad presne iba niektoré črty a niektoré charakteristiky typické pre autizmus, tak ako keby to veľmi nevedeli pochopiť. Až kým sa niekto neopýtal teda, že a čítali ste tú štúdiu toho Hansa Aspergera, ktorý hovorí o tom autistickom spektre, aj keď on to nazýval kontinuum. No a tú štúdiu nikto nečítal, pretože Hans Asperger po 1938 pracoval pre nacistov, štúdiu vydal v nemeckom časopise, nemecky hovoriacom, po nemecky napísanom. A po druhej svetovej vojne nikto nechcel čítať jednak po nemecky a jednak nie psychologa, ktorý pracoval pre nacistov. Ale práve tam bolo napísané teda, že autizmus je spektrum, a že ten Kanner s tou svojou úzkou definíciou sa mýli a vtedy sa celá tá diagnóza rozšírila. Today, autism is still a thing that we know a lot more about than we did, but we still don't know all of it. I think there are still questions that are unanswered. What can we say about its roots and its nature, given that now we know that it's such a large spectrum?
Well, if you think about it, autistic people are one of the largest minorities on Earth. And the question is, does this group of huge group of people deserve dignity, deserve respect, deserve self-determination? Yes, they do. I think they do. So it's become, in a way, not just a question of medicine or disorder or fixing something that's broken. It's a question of, do we respect these people as they are and change the world around them so that it's easier to be autistic and to have a successful life? And I'll give you an example. Many autistic people, perhaps as much as a third of autistic people, struggle with using language at least sometimes. Some of them cannot speak at all. Some of them will never speak. Some of them cannot speak if they're very stressed, which happens a lot because stress and anxiety are common in autism. So what do we do with people who can't walk down the street without help? We give them a wheelchair. So the question, and then we change the streets so the wheelchairs can move safely over the sidewalk. So what do we do for someone who can't speak or who struggles to use speech? Well, we live in the digital era. Now we have stuff like iPads that can take typed input and produce a human voice. Shouldn't autistic kids who cannot speak have access to iPads? They should. Because if you could not speak, could not say, I'm hungry, I need to go to the bathroom, you would get very frustrated. And kids who are described as nonverbal, even if they understand every word that's said around them, have that same frustration. But many of them, not all, but many of them, if they get something like an iPad or some other form of helpful technology, can use speech and communicate with those people around them and have more control over their lives. So I would say the general direction now is to stop thinking of autistic people as flawed or broken or, you know, et cetera, and think of them as people who need accommodations and assistance the same way that people with physical disabilities might need a walker or a wheelchair.
Mm-hmm. Opýtal som sa na to, že čo teda vieme o dnešnej situácii ohľadne autizmu povedať. Steve mi vysvetlil teda, že keď si to tak zoberieme, tak autizmus je taký častý, že ľudia s autizmom patria medzi tie najväčšie menšiny na svete. A otázka, tá zásadná znie, že či si zaslúžia nejakú úctu, nejaký rešpekt, či majú právo na seba určenie. Že to nie je len medicínska otázka a nebavíme sa iba o nejakej poruche, ale že tá otázka je, že či ich budeme rešpektovať a či sa budeme snažiť to nejak upraviť ten svet tak, aby mohli byť úspešní. Pretože napríklad, keď niekto nemôže chodiť, tak sa snažíme mu, dáme mu napríklad kreslo a upravíme tie ulice tak, aby sa mohol pohybovať. A možno až 1/3 autistických detí má problém s jazykom. Niektoré nerozprávajú vôbec, niektoré iba v niektorých situáciách. A že my dnes napríklad máme k dispozícii v digitálnom veku iPady, ktoré dokážu napísaný text zmeniť na hlas. A vieme to urobiť úplne bez problémov. A že môžeme si napríklad predstaviť tak, že teda existujú tie neverbálne deti, ktoré pociťujú frustráciu. A je to rovnaká frustrácia, ako keď my niečo chceme a nedokážeme to povedať, alebo nám to niekto nedokáže splniť, tak by sme to mali vnímať ako takú motiváciu na to, aby sme teda sa na ľudí s autizmom pozerali ako na ľudí, ktorí potrebujú pomoc a prispôsobenie a pochopenie. Some of our readers are reacting. Some of the audience, one of the ladies wrote, I am a mother of a little boy with Asperger and I recommend this book. It's very important to tell the people what's happening and get them to know more about the autistic spectrum. So thank you very much for that.
Thank you very much.
Ak máte akékoľvek otázky, píšte nám ich na Facebook. My potom niektoré z nich pokojne veľmi radi vyberieme. The book is called Neurotribes, which is actually a name or a word that you came up with.
Yes, that's true. That's because instead of thinking of autistic people as people who share a disease or a diagnosis, I wanted to give the sense that they're a sort of a natural tribe of people who exist and have existed for a very long time. Because when I started researching neurotribes, it was believed that autistic people were very rare. That's wrong, as we've talked about. It was believed that autism was caused by vaccines. That's wrong, as we've talked about. And so it was as if all these autistic people suddenly appeared out of nowhere and had never before existed in history. And that's completely wrong. Even before Asperger and Connor, there was a psychiatrist in the Soviet Union called Grunia Sukhareva, who wrote perfect, very vivid, and in fact, witty descriptions of teenagers with what would later be called Asperger syndrome. So autistic people have been here all along, long before there was a name for them. And so I wanted to make the point by inventing the word neurotribes that autism was not some big, huge mystery caused by something recent in history. Autistic people have been part of humanity, contributing to humanity's progress all along.
Mm-hmm. Teraz túto knihu vyberiem, lebo je naozaj krásna, ako vidíte. A všimnete si, že sa volá Neurokmene. A to slovo Neurokmene si Steve vlastne sám vymyslel a opýtal som sa ho, že prečo. A povedal mi, že nechce, aby autizmus bol vnímaný ako nejaká choroba alebo ako nejaká diagnóza, ktorá tých ľudí spája, ale že skôr chcel navodiť pocit, že ide o nejaký prirodzený kmeň ľudí, ktorý už dlho existuje, je to s nami úplne od začiatku, aj keď sa začal venovať výskumu na túto knihu, tak zistil, že vlastne, že kedy sa myslelo, že tých ľudí je málo, to vieme, že nie je pravda. Myslelo sa, že vakcíny spôsobujú autizmus, aj to vieme, že nie je pravda. A potom pre zmenu zrazu ako keby boli všade, pričom nikdy predtým, ako keby ich nebolo vidieť, a to takisto nie je pravda. Spomínali sme tu rôznych psychológov z minulosti, ktorí sa rôzne snažili ten autizmus zadefinovať, ale aj napríklad aj v Sovietskom zväze existovali štúdie detí, ktoré dnes by sme pomenovali práve ako deti s Aspergerom. A práve preto aj Steve hovorí, že autizmus by nemal byť tajomstvom, nie je to diagnóza, ale že tu bol s nami vždy a že títo ľudia naopak dokážu veľmi rôznym spôsobom prispieť do nášho sveta. I'm just checking some of the reactions. There is a group of parents and of people with autism here in Slovakia, and they are reaching out to you to say thank you. Their book is very important for you.
I'll just
quote now what they're saying. Yeah. We live in a society that is behind, not only in the medical sense, but also when it comes to popular topics and the way we discuss people with autism. So we really hope that this book will help add another piece of the puzzle so that people will know that people with autism should be respected just the way we are. Thank you for your work.
Excellent.
Thank you. Thank you for your reaction to, to the people who are contacting us.
Well, one thing, let me say one thing. One thing that I'm very, very happy about is that even the very first book signing that I did in a bookstore, many of the people there were autistic. And so I'm very, very happy about the fact that autistic people also enjoy my book and see that the message of acceptance and celebration of the special qualities of autism and demanding accommodations in public life for people with autism, that they are see me as an ally. And I'm very honored by that. Mm-hmm. And I really wish you folks luck there in Slovakia as well.
Ocitoval som tu teraz Steve-ovi jednu zo správ, ktoré nám prišli nám zo Združenia Bez návodu, ktoré spája ľudí s Aspergerom a s autizmom a ktorí mu ďakujú a my im držíme palce. A Steve na to zareagoval tak, že je veľmi rád, že napríklad to úplne prvú podpisovú akciu, ktorú mám s touto knihou, práve tam sa mnoho ľudí s autizmom objavilo a že sú, a aj on s veľkým potešením zistil, že tá kniha ich zaujala a oslovila ich, pretože jeho cieľom je ako keby vyslať ten signál, že dôležité je prijatie, dôležité je ocenenie ako keby tých špeciálnych rôznych kvalít a otvorenie a prijatie do spoločnosti a hovorí, že on je určite ich spojencom. Another word that you're using is neurodiversity.
Yes.
What's that?
Neurodiversity was a word invented by a woman named Judy Singer. Judy Singer was in a, she was a graduate student in Australia, and she herself is autistic, and she has an autistic daughter as well. And she basically thought that every word that society gave her to describe her autism was a bad word. Deficit, impairment, disorder. She thought, I need a word to describe conditions like autism that does not contain a negative judgment. So she was thinking of other slogans and words like Black is beautiful, which was the rallying cry for the civil rights movement in America, or sisterhood is powerful, which was the cry of feminists in the 1970s and 80s, and gay is good, which was the cry of homosexuals who were also given a diagnosis up until the mid 1970s. Homosexuality was considered a disease, more or less, or a perversion or a crime until the 1970s. But with the slogan, gay is good, it restored pride and self-respect to a group of people. So she and a writer named Harvey Bloom came up with the word neurodiversity to describe conditions like autism, ADHD, dyslexia, and other conditions. And she hoped that that would inspire people with those conditions to stop thinking of themselves as damaged or flawed, and to start thinking of themselves as people who had rights that were worth fighting for. And so the word neurodiversity has really taken off worldwide. In fact, there was a conference on neurodiversity in Ghana, Africa, a couple of years ago that I couldn't go to, unfortunately. But in the same way that slogans like, you know, sisterhood is powerful, really raised the respect and self-respect of a community, she hoped that neurodiversity would do the same thing for people with conditions like autism, dyslexia, and ADHD.
Mm-hmm. Opýtal som sa aj na slovo neurodiverzita, ktoré sa aj v podtitule knihy, ten podtitul je Príbehy autizmu a neurodiverzity, nachádza sa tam, že čo to vlastne znamená. Steve mi povedal, že v Austrálii teda bola vysokoškolská študentka Judy Singer, ktorá bola sama mala autizmus a jej dcéra mala autizmus a vlastne si uvedomila, že všetky slova, ktoré sa bežne používajú, majú nejakú zlú konotáciu. Sa hovorí o deficite, o chorobe alebo o nejakom postihnutí a že vlastne ona potrebuje slovo, ktoré by nemalo takýto negatívny význam a že v duchu takých tých hesiel, ktoré boli napríklad, že čierna je krásna, to bolo hnutie za občianske práva v Spojených štátoch alebo gay is good pre LGBT komunity. Veľmi pomohli týmto komunitám v tom, aby nejakým spôsobom si uvedomili svoju hodnotu a aby sa dokázali zjednotiť. Tak táto Judy Singer práve preto s Harvim Bloomom vymysleli slovo neurodiverzita pre ľudí s autizmom, pre ľudí s ADHD, pre ľudí s dyslexiou a vymysleli ho hlavne preto, aby oni sami začali o sebe inak rozmýšľať, že sú to ľudia s nejakými právami a ľudia s naozaj aj hodnotou. It's one of the things that's very important, and it's also important to me, even during this interview, and I know it as an author and a writer myself, that language is very important. Words matter. Yeah. It matters yeah. what you say and how you say it.
Yeah.
Is there a way that we could change our language and our behavior and maybe our thinking, anything that you would like people of Slovakia to know?
Sure. Autistic people are both different from non-autistic people and the same as non-autistic people. They deserve the same respect. They have the same desires to control their own lives. They want to fall in love. They are capable of love. They're capable of deep feelings. They're capable of deep empathy. Many of those qualities that make people human, the medical establishment over the decades has said autistic people don't have. You know, they have claimed that autistic people don't have the ability to love or don't want to be in relationships. That's not true. We have to understand that many, many people in our society, and virtually everyone who's listening to this, even if they don't have an autistic child or a spouse, or even if they're not autistic themselves, there are autistic people in their lives. And we have to become more aware that if someone does not want to be social, if someone seems bothered by the noise of fluorescent lights in an office, that perhaps they're autistic. And we should be willing to make accommodations, just like we make accommodations for people with physical disabilities, for people with cognitive disabilities like autism. And basically, autistic people have been, there's something that I write about in my book a lot, which we have not talked about yet, is that because of some of the technological advantages or forms of memory or forms of imagination, even imagining science fiction, autistic people have been contributing to the progress of science, art, culture, mathematics, physics. I write about a very famous physicist named Dirac. I write about a pioneering, it's almost too small to call him a pioneering scientist because he invented many different fields of science, a guy named Henry Cavendish. These people have been contributing to the progress of humanity for centuries. And instead, we've been treating them like they were sick and broken. For instance, the only reason why Henry Cavendish was able to become a pioneering scientist was because his father was wealthy, and so he wasn't sent to a mental asylum. If his father had been poor, Henry would have been sent to a mental asylum, and we would never have gotten the benefit of his many, many scientific discoveries. Mm-hmm. So what I hope is that autistic people are given the best chance of having a happy, healthy, meaningful life, and we can do it. It's not impossible. But it means that we have to, you know, one of our coworkers at the office is like waving their hands. If we understand that that's one way that autistic people calm themselves down, it's called stimming. We can, you know, people can handle that. You know, it's like, it's there are many different changes that can be made that would make it easier for autistic people to live happy and healthy and meaningful lives. And so we should fight for those changes.
Mm-hmm. Just another reaction. I'll translate it straight away, but
sure.
Another reaction.
Hold on.
No problem.
Mm-hmm. Ah. Oh boy. So sorry about that.
No problem. Sorry. No problem at all.
Yeah.
I'll just translate for you another reaction from another reader. I am an autistic adult with an autistic son, and I want to let you know that that what Mr. Silberman is doing for us has been life changing. Wow. And maybe here's a question, because she's also saying, I would like to say the same about Barry Prisant.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Thank you.
Okay, we'll talk about that in a bit. Yes. I'll just translate what you said before. Opýtal som sa Steve'a na to, že či existuje napríklad nejaký špeciálny jazyk, nejaký taký citlivejší, alebo možno to ani neuvedomujeme, alebo niečo, čo môžeme urobiť. Steve povedal, že ľudia s autizmom sú iní ako my a sú zároveň rovnakí ako my, pretože majú rovnaké túžby, dokážu sa rovnako zamilovať, majú hlboké city, hoci predtým tá medicína tvrdila, že to tak nie je. A že napríklad my to ani nemusíme úplne vedieť, ale určite každý z nás toho človeka s autizmom má niekde vo svojom okolí. Že to môže byť človek, ktorému vadí hluk alebo ostré svetla, alebo úplne si nevychutnáva spoločnosť. Rovnako je to napríklad aj s kolegami, že keď vidíte, ako niekto napríklad takto robí rukami, takže to je jeden zo spôsobov, ako sa ľudia s autizmom upokojujú a my s tým určite dokážeme žiť. A hlavne ľudia s autizmom boli už v minulosti veľkí umelci, dôležitú úlohu v kultúre, vo vede, v matematike, vo fyzike. Spomenul Henryho Cavendisha. Henry Cavendish, tam v tej knihe hneď v úvode sa o ňom píše, toho človek, ktorý vymyslel celé vedné disciplíny, aby dokázal to vďaka tomu, že bol z bohatej rodiny. Ak by z bohatej rodiny nebol, tak by skončil v sanatóriu a nikdy by sme sa o ňom nedozvedeli. Takže to množstvo ľudí, ktoré nám pomohlo, je naozaj nekonečné. A tu ešte sme teda mali reakciu od jednej z diváčky, ktorá hovorí, že rovnako si cení aj prácu Barryho Prisanta a teraz Steve o ňom možno niečo povie, čo si o ňom myslí. So now it's your time to say something about Barry Prisant.
Yeah, Barry Prisant is the author of a book that's in English is called Uniquely Human. I don't know if it's been translated yet for your country, but it's an excellent, excellent book. And in fact, my own book, Neurotribes and Uniquely Human, came out the same month. And me and Barry Prisant instantly recognized that they were like sister books in a way. My book was the history, and his book was the way to apply the history into modern life. And so we're friends. Barry is amazing. And Uniquely Human is a very, very important book, particularly for the parents of autistic kids who are struggling with what usually gets described as difficult behavior. If you want to understand what is happening in your child's mind when they're having difficult behavior, autistic behavior, Uniquely Human is a very good insight into that.
Mm-hmm. Now I'm fine. I'm learning that it's been translated to Czech, which is a language that we're familiar with. So I'll just tell everyone. Barry Prisant teda je s autorom knihy, ktorá v češtine vyšla. Nazýva sa Jedineční lidé. A môžete si ju prečítať. Steve hovorí, že vlastne je to kniha, ktorá je výborná, lebo vyšla v rovnakom mesiaci ako jeho kniha Neurokmene. Také ako keby sesterské knihy, pretože Neurokmene sú... je tam veľmi veľa z histórie a v tých jedinečných ľuďoch je zrazu to, ako to môžete aplikovať v tom skutočnom živote a v tej realite. Je to veľmi dôležitá kniha napríklad pre rodičov, ktorí majú deti a tie deti trpia, alebo je im pripísané tzv. To zložité správanie, tak sa môžete dozvedieť, čo vaše deti prežívajú a čo by mohli potrebovať a ako by ste im mohli pomôcť. We've got 5 minutes to go. I think it's unfortunately time for one last question. Has the book, it's very obviously from what I see on screen now, from the reactions, it's a very important book for a lot of people here in Slovakia. Has the book changed your life or yourself or your perception of our world in any way?
Yes, absolutely. When I was writing the book, I knew that it was not like any other autism book that had ever been published in history. And I thought maybe that was bad. You know, I thought maybe everyone would hate it and that it would be the end of my career. I was very afraid of that, particularly as a book that was supposed to be like about 150 pages turned into, at some point it was 850 pages. Oh. So the 550 page version that got published is actually shorter than, you know, it was at some point. But at some point I thought maybe I was completely off base and just, you know, that everyone would hate it and that, you know, the people who hate vaccines would hate it, because I talk about some of the mistakes that famous clinicians like Leo Kanner made. I thought maybe clinicians would hate it, but it ended up being very widely accepted. And I won a big award in England called the Samuel Johnson Prize, now called the Bailey Gifford Prize. This was all a surprise to me. I thought I would die in obscurity having written a book that no one would ever read, you know? But having people like the father who just made that comment about he and his son and that the book was life-changing, that I've heard many, many, you know, thank God, I've heard many, many comments like that. And so I feel like my life was not a waste. You know, I helped make the world a little bit better, and helping to make the world a little bit better is that's enough for me. That's good. And so of course I'm going to keep writing, but it's given me a feeling of that while I was here on earth, I did something that made life better for some people. And that makes me very, very happy.
Wonderful. Thank you. Opýtal som sa Steve'a na to, že či mu kniha zmenila možno život alebo pohľad na svet, alebo možno sa niečo naučil a hovorí, že teda on keď to začínal písať, túto knihu Neurokmeň, povedal si, že to bude úplne iná kniha o autizme ako všetky ostatné, že možno sa nikomu nebude páčiť, že mu to ukončí kariéru, hlavne keď teda mala pôvodne 150 strán, potom mala 850, takže tých 500 strán je taký kompromis. A hovoril si, že možno bude úplne mimo, že možno klinickí odborníci ju odmietnú, ale nakoniec ona je aj oceňovaná v Británii, napríklad získal, ktorý sa to volalo Samuel Johnson Prize. Nestalo sa teda to, že ju nikto nebude čítať. Čítajú veľa ľudí, dostáva veľa reakcií, tak ako my sme tu dnes niektoré uvádzali vďačných od ľudí, ktorým táto kniha pomohla. A tak si hovorí, že nežil úplne zbytočne, že trochu sa mu podarilo, kým tu bol, tak zlepšiť tento svet a že bude ďalej písať a že ďalej sa bude o niečo podobné snažiť a že potom je všetko úplne v poriadku. Steve, thank you so much. I think that's a nice way and a nice thought to conclude our interview with each and one of us trying to make the world a little bit better. And if we all do that, then I think we'll all be better off in the end.
I think so too. And thank you so much, Samuel and Dušan and Philip Ostrowski. And I really appreciate your support. And thank you to everyone who watched, and good luck to autistic people in Slovakia.
Ďakujeme Steve'ovi. Myslím, že pekne sme to zakončili takouto myšlienkou, že keď sa každý trošku viac posnaží, tak nakoniec bude trochu lepšie. Steve nám poďakoval všetkým, poďakoval vám, ktorí ste nás sledovali, pozdravuje všetkých ľudí, ktorí sa nejakým spôsobom potýkajú s autizmom. Pozdravujeme vás všetkých, držíme vám palce. Ešte vám poslednýkrát pripomeniem, tu je kniha Neurokmene, ktorá vychádza vo vydavateľstve Absint. A dnes sme sa rozprávali s jej autorom, so Stevem Zilbermanom zo San Francisca. Steve, thank you again very much and have a good day in San Francisco and good luck to whatever you choose to do next.
You too. Thank you so much. Take care. Thank you. Bye-bye.